Hi everyone, welcome to our final session today, which looks at documentary. We're very lucky to have with us Sanjay Singhal, CEO of Voltage TV. Sanjay began his career at the BBC and then moved to independent production company Dragonfly before setting up his own company, Voltage TV. At Voltage, he's earned a reputation for colossal projects that create a big splash. We'll be looking at clips from some of these in the session and talking to Sanjay about what it takes to be top of the documentary game in today's television culture. As usual, there'll be a couple of opportunities throughout the session to ask questions. So Sanjay, hello. I'm going to start with an easy one for you. Tell us about how you came to make documentaries. I found out that you did a law degree. I didn't know that. But clearly being a lawyer was not for you.
Yeah, I mean, look, I went to state school in London, and at that stage it was really media and stuff was not anything that any of my friends or anyone talked about. It's not an industry that anyone I knew ended up in. And therefore, when it came to applying to university, which obviously I left to the very last minute and scrabbling around trying to think what degree to do, given that I'd blown my parents' dreams of becoming a doctor and that was never going to happen, there was a sort of television programme at the time called LA Law, which made it all look very glamorous and really exciting. So I thought, OK, I'll apply to do that, it's going to be great. And quickly found out that law was anything like that, in that you're just sitting around doing conveyancing all day long. So I think when I was at uni, which is at Sussex, I got really into photography. I was into photography before, and I became a photojournalist for the student newspaper there. And I suddenly realised I was enjoying that a lot more than doing a law degree. So I spent a lot more time doing that. And then from that, I applied to do a journalism course, a postgrad in newspaper journalism, and through that ended up on a sort of training scheme at the BBC. And I guess without sort of boring on for too long, once I'd got into the BBC, and I spent about 10 years as a journalist, so I was there, I was trained by the BBC as a journalist, I was very fortunate to get a job. Although, I have to say, it didn't happen immediately. The first job I went for at the BBC, which is another board for a different training scheme, it went so badly that she just stopped asking me questions after through. There was like it was sort of complete car crash of an interview. But I spent 10 years as a journalist and ended up as the BBC's Washington producer, so I was covering all of North American news for BBC television. And the final week I was there was the week of 9/11. So after having done the sort of reporting on 9/11, which is obviously a traumatic but colossal story, after that I think I thought I've sort of done it all now. And I, you know, it just felt that where else would you go in the world of news? So I left and went into factual TV.
And was it quite a sort of jump from journalism to making documentaries? How did you find that transition?
I think the biggest thing I found was the culture is really different, because in the world of journalism, I used to work at Newsnight for a while, and it was not dissimilar from the other programmes I'd worked on. And Newsnight at the time was quite really aggressive, like ferociously intellectual and quite savage place, probably still is. And, you know, it wasn't a system of collaboration and creative camaraderie. It was dog eat dog, survival of the fittest, and therefore your instincts were to kill. It wasn't good enough that your idea was good. It had to be, you had to kill everyone else's idea in the room for your ideas to stand out. That was the culture. It was really aggressive, Rottweiler, and that was fine. I kind of quite enjoyed it at the time. But then when you went into a world of everyone sitting around in beanbags and they're brainstorming ideas and everyone's and working in teams, and I thought, wait, this is completely different, alien. So I found that was the biggest leap, actually, going from a sort of dog-eat-dog mindset in journalism, which I think, I don't know if it still is like that, but it certainly was in my day, to a much more collegiate and teamwork-based idea. Editorially, there are differences, but that was what I found the biggest difference initially to be.
That's really interesting. And I've known you for a long time, and I know this to be true. You're a big believer in risk-taking. Tell us about why you think that's important to you personally, and you know, what lessons can our audiences learn from that?
Okay. I suppose there's two aspects of my approach towards risk taking is, and we'll come to the first of those, which is creative risk taking and how you, editorial and as program makers, take as much risk as you can. So we'll, hopefully we'll come on to that with some of the programs and whatever. Maybe we took too many risks, right? But I think there's then also the question about how much risk do you take as an individual, and where do you go to with the choices you make? Now, I say to full knowledge that it's hard enough just to get a job, right? So I'm not saying any of this stuff is easy, but I suppose in my life what I found was that from the privileged position of being someone who had the work, there were moments when people would come to you and they'd offer you the opportunity to take something on, which I really wasn't sure I was ready for, and it happened again and again and again. And I suppose in that situation, I never pushed for it. I was very rarely angling or asking for, can I have a go at that? Can you promote me? Can I do this? Whatever. But if somebody came to me and said, can you do this? I'd often think they're not stupid, these people. They must be asking me for a reason. They have some degree of belief that I could do it, even if I didn't feel it. Sometimes they were like, really, what, me? You know, usually it's somebody else in the room you're talking to. But I always took that opportunity. And I example being a bit further down in my career, but it happened all the way through. And sometimes you're terrified, by the way. You are terrified by taking on that responsibility when you don't necessarily feel quite ready for it. But I remember being asked, I'd series produced two programmes. I'd only been in factual TV out of journalism for about 2 or 3 years, so I was really green. And somebody called me up and asked me to make The Apprentice, to run it. And I was quite shocked because that was a huge show. This is back in 2005, so it was right in the early days of The Apprentice. And it was one of the biggest shows. And at that stage, we didn't really know what we were doing and how to make it. And I just thought, this is a step too far. But I couldn't resist, you know, I'm addicted to the sort of creative ambition. So I took it on, and it was a real, real learning curve. So I suppose what I mean by risk-taking is, I'd always encourage people to sort of think, if you get an opportunity and you're not sure about it, but you feel you're in an environment that will back you, take it. And I just say one other thing on that, because I know you're... This is important, right?
We talked about this, yes.
And you were sort of saying it's all fine, but how does that translate? And I suppose even later in my life, after that, I was offered, I was creative director in a company that Fozzie and I worked in at the same time called Dragonfly. And the guys who'd founded the company were brilliant program makers. They left, they quit, they founded it, they'd gone. And then suddenly I got a call from Elizabeth Murdoch, who's obviously part of the Murdoch family and owned the group, and she said, right, I want you to take on the job, run the company. And I was like, well, this is crazy. I've never even run like a lemonade stall. I mean, what do I know about running a company? And I was, you know, I said, I don't want to do it. I don't want to fail. Like, this is not for me. And she said, and I remember it, she said, I won't let you fail, right? And I sort of thought, okay, fine. She's got my back here. This is a big job. This is going to be really, really difficult. I'll take it if I believe the environment is such where they mean it. So what I'd say to you is, if you feel you've got an opportunity and you trust someone around you to say they've got your back and they'll cover you and they'll help you, I take it. Don't be afraid. No one knows what they're doing, right? Everyone's got the imposter syndrome. Everyone's got the fake it till you make it sort of thing. We all have. And therefore, it takes a degree of, I think, total arrogance to sort of think, hey, of course I can do it, right? Everyone's got the self-doubt. So I just wouldn't let it put you off as long as you feel that the, you know, I'd sort of take it on and do your best.
Yeah, I think that's really good advice. I mean, I personally, I'm also a big believer in risk-taking. I think it's also having someone in your life that you can be very honest with is really important when you're feeling scared and you can really talk it through. Did you have that as well, like where you could ring up and say, I don't know what I'm doing, what shall I do about this, you know?
Yes, absolutely, to some extent. Sometimes it might be peer group, right? Sometimes it might just be someone else who can say, join the club, right? And yes, you're right, sometimes there will be bosses, but it might not be quite, I've no idea what I'm doing. It might just be, look, I've got a problem here, I need to, you know, it's obvious stuff, right? You've got a problem. But I suppose the truth is, I think you don't want to bring every problem to your boss's door, but you'd be surprised by how receptive people be to people having an honest conversation. I'd rather hear from my team that they're having an issue and they don't quite know how to handle it, what to do, rather than plough on and dig themselves into a hole, which is going to be problematic for them and difficult for us, right? I'd much rather you have an easier conversation, which you put your hand up earlier and say, listen, you know, I'm getting in a bit of trouble here, I need a bit of help. No one's going to mind people who are, by the way, not just new to the industry, but even when you're experienced, and I've had lots of very experienced people do it, no one's going to mind you saying, I need some help here.
Brilliant. Well, look, let's take a look at your first clip, which is probably one of the riskiest projects ever attempted on television. It was a Channel 4 documentary called The Plane Crash. And I think it says it did what it says on the tin. Should we have a look?
Mexicali Tower, Mike November, Papa, starting engines.
On its last ever flight, a Boeing 727 is cleared for takeoff.
Be advised, big flow now taxiing. Big flow now taxiing.
All the passengers and crew are checked in. The flight time is 40 minutes. But this is no ordinary flight.
Starting final approach turn.
This plane is going to crash.
5 miles, 2,000 feet.
And the crew on board are here to make sure that it does.
Exit, exit, exit.
Crashing this plane will be the grand finale of 4 years of meticulous planning. But only if they make it out alive.
2 miles.
An international team of scientists, inventors, and elite test pilots.
It's all about the end game. Everything else goes for naught if we don't pull it off.
Gathers to pull off the most audacious flight of the century, one that they hope will save lives.
This is a unique experience in being able to see the aircraft beforehand and watch it crash.
Together, they're going to buy a plane, pack it full of state-of-the-art research equipment, and then crash it.
We crash cars all the time. We don't do that with planes just to see if we could make them safer or not, which is what makes this such a unique opportunity.
Amazing, I remember that. I remember that very clearly. It was such a moment in television history. Now, I know this wasn't your idea, and it had been commissioned before you got involved, but can you tell us a little bit about how it got commissioned and why you agreed to take it on?
Yeah, well, it's quite helpful sometimes to understand how these projects come to fruition and the sort of insane way that an idea like that will happen. So I think there was a producer called Jeff Dean who went in with a long list of ideas, just literally words on a piece of paper, to a commissioner called David Glover. And David just circled one title, plane crash, is all it said. He said, I like that, can you go and look into it? And he did, and he was, is it viable? Jeff thought it was viable. David thought he was too small a producer to make it work, so paired him up with a company which I was at, which was Dragonfly, and I wasn't running it at the time, I was still creative director. They'd taken it on and then approached it like any conventional production, which is, right, let's just make it like we make any television show. And we'll crack on with it. And then it sort of hit massive obstacles. And so about I can't remember, 9 months later or something, I took over the company and I inherited this project, which was really in a lot of trouble. It was bleeding money. It was overspending like crazy. We had bought a plane, that plane, but nothing else was achieved. You know, you sort of realise we had nowhere to crash it. No government would give us permission. We had no sort of actual plan for what we'd do on board the plane or what would happen afterwards. We had no insurance. We had, you know, there were just like so many unanswered questions. And so, but we had a team of filmmakers who were ready to do it, but nothing actually to happen. So what I suppose what I did, and I suppose one of the reasons I wanted to talk about this program a bit is that you can look at a production like that and think, well, it's just massive, right? But I suppose the thing is, I thought that too. But all I did in it, with it in the end, was sort of, okay, there are just different steps here. However big the production, whether it's that or whether it's a short film you're making, there are just a series of problems. Break them down, fix every problem one by one. Assign somebody to do it, work out who's the right person to fix that problem and just go on that basis. And in this case, what we realised quite quickly was that this wasn't really a television programme at all. It was an exercise in sort of project management and aviation sort of disaster planning. So I got rid of everyone from the team. I didn't sort of fire them, but I said, okay, you're not needed for at least a couple of years. And I put it solely in the hands of a team who had nothing to do with television, who would just say, how do we actually make this happen? And so their job was to work with international authorities, federal aviation authorities and so on, to pitch this idea around the world and to put in place every single component part. You know, I'll give you an example. No one had thought through the insurance thing. We thought, it'll be fine, we found out insurance company. And I said, well, what's the problem, guys? Because we don't want any money back. We're going to crash the plane and then you don't have to pay us anything, so it's fine. I said, Sang, let me guess right, you're going to take off and then there's going to be a large plane flying above a populated area with no crew on board. That is really a major problem that no one's going to insure you for. So there were all of these things that needed to be resolved. And it was only when we finally got the permission from Mexico to crash the plane in Mexico that I then brought the team back on. At that stage, it was quite late in the day because there were only 7 weeks left to do it. So we suddenly shut everything down in the company, brought everyone in, science producers, directors, whatever, and threw the company at it for the next 7 weeks. No one did anything else, night or day, until that plane was crashed. And it came very close to not happening. So that's effectively how I took it on. But I would say the other thing about a project like that is, although now I look back and think one of my proudest achievements, I love the film and I love the fact we actually managed to pull it off and it was front page news all around the world. There were many, many, many times all the way through that 4-year period where I would have given anything for somebody to put a bullet in this production and just put me out of my misery and say, okay, look, don't worry about it. You won't have lost money. We'll just cover the cost so far and you don't need to do it anymore. And it would have been fantastic if so, and I've been in many productions, you feel the same, right? Somebody just get me out of here. But it shows you the value of perseverance and it shows you the value of like actually just how you can break down any big problem and on sort of individual parts.
You don't get riskier than that. So tell us a little bit about the production and a couple of days before the crash, what was going on?
So we were all down in Mexico. So basically we had the different channels were there and all the press and everything else. So this is quite a big deal we're building up towards. And we had this crew, they were ex-Navy test pilots who were about the most experienced sort of pilots you can get who were going to run the operation. And the slight problem was the GPS system was not as good as like Uber's. They kept missing the target. So, they weren't crashing the plane, but every time they flew over it, they just couldn't find the runway. And the runway had been lined with all manner of like super slow-mo cameras and so had to hit the runway.
This is where it was going to crash.
Yeah. And then we had cameramen off to the side and whatever else. Obviously, it's got to hit somewhere. And then we had fire crew and military and everything within a 2-kilometer circle to get to it very quickly because we had all this data on board. We couldn't let it burn out. So we've got to get to it fast. And so they turn up on the morning and they said, they turned up the night before and said, it's still not accurate. But we're going to have to crash it anyway because we're running out of time, so see you in the morning. Oh, but because we're so wide off, you can't have anybody filming it anywhere near. I said, well, hang on a minute. You can't just crash this plane with no one filming it. That's not the point. That's not the reason we're here. And so we had a near mutiny where they nearly walked off the project. And then they decided to come back on board. And then that day there was terrible weather. And so they couldn't fly. And so then the next day was the last day we could possibly crash the plane. The permit ran out and there was no chance of renewing it. So we all got up and the wind was okay. And then we all set off. It was 4 a.m, everyone got up and the plane went up and I remember feeling really sick. And then I was watching as the plane flew over my head. It went down in the distance. I couldn't see where it went down, but I'm thinking that doesn't feel right. And then we were trying to phone and then the cameraman said, I think he's missed it by quite a long way. And then we got further news that the cameraman who was off to the side said, I think he's missed it by 2 kilometres, right? To miss the target site. And I was thinking, everyone was high-fiving and celebrating. And I was thinking, wait, we've just conducted the most expensive television programme ever made. We haven't filmed any of it. But what had happened shows you the virtue of actually listening to people. One of my team had, against my better wishes, had suggested that we get a helicopter in, just in case. He'd only suggested that 2 days before. So it was extra money, but he made a convincing case. We listened to him, we got a helicopter in. And what happened was, although every single camera, and it was hundreds of them, had missed it, this camera that was on a helicopter with the cameraman leaning out the helicopter, like right out, managed to capture the cache, and we had one from above, from a wing plane on us. So we just about got the crash, just about enough to make it work. So it was very close to being sort of probably, I think if we'd come back from Mexico without footage of that crash, I think I wouldn't have worked in TV again. it's not even a joke. I don't think I could have shown up anywhere. It'd been too humiliating.
Oh, I love that story. how do you feel looking back on that now? Do you feel like, having done that, you can just do anything? Having done the most risky project ever, nothing else scares you?
Yeah, we talked about this as well, Fossey, didn't we? I remember actually when I went for an interview once, actually before to join the company that made that programme. And at that stage, I hadn't made anything as big as that, but I certainly felt that by exposing myself to quite a range of different types of productions and, you know, covering 9/11 and, you know, lots of different, The Apprentice, etc., I felt genuinely that I'd lost all of my fear of television. I just wasn't scared by it anymore. And that was like 15 years ago. I definitely felt by then, there's nothing you can throw at me because I understood the basics of it. The basics were get good people, understand what are the sequence of problems you need to fix, make a plan and execute and adapt as you go along. It's really actually quite simple, right? The only problem is if you fundamentally look at that plan and think it's undeliverable. Either it's undeliverable because it's undeliverable, or because the money doesn't work out, or because the timescale is impossible. But fundamentally, I sort of thought, if I can look at it and think, yeah, maybe, it's worth a go. So I think now, genuinely, nothing worries me. I mean, I will be anxious during it, don't get me wrong, I'm not being cocky about it. Things will definitely present problems where I think, I wish I'd never taken this on. But I'm not worried, I'm not scared by television anymore. And I think that will come, it comes to everyone, I think.
I had the same experience on a production which went terribly wrong, came out of it alive.
And yes, well, that was a great example, as it was, Fozzie. Fozzie managed to spend £1 million of Channel 4 money and hadn't shot a single frame. And all they had to do was...
I think it's a record.
All they had to do was film a family, that was it. It wasn't like she was crashing a plane. She had to film a family, but the thing
Thanks,
was...
Thanks, Sanjay.
Yeah, but to be fair, Fozzie was doing a production with the same company where they were... It was the very first rig show, you know, the rig show with 24 hours and one born every minute, and Fozzie was... brilliant enough to be working on the very first pioneering one, and they had to find a family that would allow to
put... Well, yeah, we put cameras in their house, which, you know, sounds very simple, but was, yeah, had never been done before. But I know exactly what you mean. You know, you kind of go there and then you think nothing can be that bad. I think it's a good opportunity to ask a couple of questions. I'm only going to take a couple at a time. You put your hand up very fast.
Hello, my name's Layla, and I wanted to ask, as someone who really wants to get into documentary, but doesn't have maybe as much experience outside of university, you know, I've worked on a lot of documentaries through uni, but not a lot of real world experience, what advice would you have for me to, you know, to get into the industry without maybe as much of relevant experience?
I think it's a really good question. I mean, I know.
Yeah, you go first.
I would say, look, it's a good question. It's asked by a lot of people that will come and see me or whatever. It's definitely different than when I was younger, which is 100 years ago or whatever. The thing is that the great advantage you've got at the moment is that the television industry is much bigger than it was. There are many more opportunities, many more companies, many more commissioners. The levels of production are unbelievable at the moment, right? So it couldn't be a better time in some ways to try to get into a very growing, fast-moving industry. And when it's growing at the pace it's growing at, it means that people will be given opportunity and more than they maybe were before. In answer to your specific question, I'd say, look, the thing you can do for yourself now is, I would say a couple of things. One is watch loads of it, right? So I think it's really important to, I know, you know, you will be watching loads, but broaden it, watch everything. You know, if you're genuinely interested in it, watch it. I also would suggest that, in fact, don't just watch it, but critically watch it. So I would say, like any programme, you're going to have two responses. You either liked it or you didn't like it. What did you like about it? What didn't you like about it? That sort of, you know, any sort of critical thinking you can start doing. You know, like when you get match of the day commentators or whatever, they're analysing the game, and you start saying, oh, that was really interesting. You're right, three at the back was a terrible strategy in that game. I sort of think doing a bit of that, sort of thinking things through a bit about what you do differently, and I would actually just say keep a notebook and write all of it down, because when you come for a chat, you'll have forgotten it all. So like starting to sort of keep notes and thoughts and whatever, I think is a really good thing. And I don't think just about television programs, but everything. I'm interested in people who are just finding creative inspiration from whatever source. It could be anything, it could be adverts, it could be posters, it could be anything at all. Like evidence that you are inspired by creative ideas and that you see that. So I'd say watch a load. Then also, but the second big point is you can actually make, right? Now I know people will then think, oh, I don't know what to make a program about, whatever. It's fine. Just edit, practice, shoot something, do something, cut something. Do you know what I mean? Even if you don't know how to edit, learn, right? And so I would say that would be the thing that you should be doing now, boosting up your skills. So when you come into a job, you can say, well, actually, you know what? I have picked up a camera. I have shot a bit of this. I have done some editing. Do you want to take a look? That's what I would do. I couldn't do that because camera technology is too expensive. Editing was not laptop editing. It was all much harder. I think you've got a real luxury here. So I would do that. Those are the main tips I would give you.
Yeah, I think that's really good. I think as well as TV programs, like, what's brilliant now is you can go on YouTube, you can watch sessions at Edinburgh, you can watch people in the industry talking about what they're looking for, what's, you know, I think all of that, just, you know, really understand the industry. And I think what Sanjay is saying is absolutely right, like just keep making stuff and refining your skills. Because if you get a job as a runner and you can cut a showreel, that's a really, really useful thing, useful skill. So yeah, I think that's really good advice.
Absolutely.
One more question. Over there.
Hi, yeah, I just wanted to ask, in your opinion, what are the news values of greatest importance that drive documentary making?
News values?
Yeah.
Authenticity, impartiality, you know, and I guess, I suppose, yeah, those are it. So you've got to be objective, you've got to be truthful, you've got to be sensitive, you've got to be balanced. So those are all the things that you try to learn as a journalist, right? Like, am I being fair? Fundamentally, are you being fair to people and to the subject? But have you also, crucially, got something to say? You know, news has something to say. There is a story. So how do you combine story, top-line sell, impartiality, and keeping it real, effectively, would be my things. Then you add to that with documentary, you start adding character and emotion and, you know, kind of like innovation, and those are all the different layers you start getting in factual that you wouldn't necessarily, and story arc and so on, narrative build. Those are all the things you start playing with in documentary that you wouldn't necessarily do in news. But the bedrock, it's a good question. The amount of documentary makers I know that have come from a journalistic background is unbelievable, right? And I always think it's a great thing, because I know if I've got somebody who's coming from that journalistic background, I mind it's not exclusive, but I know if they come from a journalistic background, they'll have those values already baked in, and also they'll probably be quite fast, and they'll be good writers, and they'll understand things about compliance and representation and stuff that might take someone else slightly longer to get to.
Yeah, really good. I mean, I think I'm sort of just echoing what Sanjay is saying, but I think that curiosity about people and that going into situations, even if you've got an opinion about it, but being open to hear what people have got to say. You know, when you're making documentaries, you're often meeting people that have very different opinions to you. You know, they might be far right when you're, you know, far left, but you have to listen to them and be curious about what they have to say.
Do you know what? Sorry, that's another good point. Sorry, it's a ballsiness, right? Because I remember as a journalist, you would suddenly have to just stop people in the street, go in their face, go and ask some questions, whatever. And you're like, you know, you're really like, do I really want to do that? And again, losing the fear is a really good thing. Journalism teaches you. I mean, I never had to do the going and knocking on doors of bereaved families or whatever else, but that's what you have to do. You have to summon it up and go there. And so I think that ability to think of everything, think fast, generate multiple ideas, that's what journalists, I think, are also very good at.
One last question.
Morning. I'm Peter Genche from Bulgaria. How did you manage this pressure, over this pressure to make this film?
That film?
Yeah.
Well, you know, I suppose the thing is you have mechanisms, right? The truth is all of us in all of our jobs face degrees of pressure, don't we? And I suspect the pressure I'm facing there is no different to the pressure you might feel in the role you're performing on any job or production you're doing. The truth is you're sort of stretched to your capability. You're wondering, what if I screw it up and what's going to go wrong? And I suppose we all have our means of dealing with that, don't we? And I guess the thing is you just, look, there was a moment there where I wasn't really dealing with the pressure, and the night before, and I went to bed thinking, these guys are going to crash the plane tomorrow and we can't film it. I felt myself visibly aging, right? Like as I lay there in bed, it was not a good moment. I was really like, but then you wake up and you think, okay, well, yeah, I'm here for a reason. I'm being paid good money for a reason. I've got to sort this, right? And so you, the way I suppose I deal with pressure and answer your question is you have to have things you can go to. I know what it is. You've got to basically, I think, and this is, I've seen it in Fozzie and the teams I like best, they deal with it because there's a sort of gallows humour, you know. There's always a way of dealing with it, which is you take it seriously, but you don't take it too seriously. Fundamentally, you want to give it your best, but you can leaven a lot of the pressure with the right approach and the right team and the right humour and whatever, which is, you know, and I think that's what gets you through it. The right team around you,
yeah, definitely,
really gets you through it.
I mean, I remember filming some surgeons and they were doing some, you know, really intricate surgery, but they had classical music playing, having a chat about what they're going to have for dinner. And I think being able to remain calm, and you know, I think an important thing to say is you learn that. It's not like you go into telly and you like do everything right. You know, you probably do get too stressed at your first job and mess up, and then you get better and you grow and you learn. So it is, you know, we've all had to learn how to do that, right? You know.
Yeah, exactly. And I remember once I was on a project. It was really early years. I was in one of my first jobs. And I'd suggested an idea and they said, okay, go and make it. So this is really big news, I'm making my own idea. And then it was going completely wrong. My idea was complete bullshit. None of it stood up. No one was agreeing with anything I said on location. And I had a moment where I remember it to this day, I remember thinking, I went and just got some bread and I found this duck pond. I sat there for 3 hours, just fed the ducks. And that was my only way I could deal with it, was I just thought I need to die. So now, I still have it whenever I'm feeling I can't cope. I just think of going finding a duck pond somewhere. Sadly, there's not that many around, but you know, I suppose you just need to take a moment, recharge. You do need to recharge. That's the other thing. Rest, take it easy, take your mind off things and come back to it afresh.
Yeah.
And by the way, it is at the end of the day only television. I've got friends who run intensive care units during COVID where people are dying in their dozens, right? That's pressure. So, you know, so basically I sort of, you know, you always have to remind yourself about what's the consequence of what you're doing.
Right, thank you for those questions. Shall we move on to our next clip, which is very different. Sanjay, do you want to set up what this is for us?
You have to remind me, is this Anna?
Anna,
okay,
yes.
So this is a very different plane crash. There's a programme which is made at Voltage. It was, we made it about well, I think we started years ago, but it was on air about 2 years ago. And it's a program called, it was called Antdex DNA Journey. And we had the good fortune to work with Britain's biggest stars, Ant and Dec. And it's a show in which they are going off to find out about their ancestral past using DNA. And in this scene, Ant, who has no idea that he's got relatives in Ireland, has just found out, I think, he's just found out that there's a village he didn't even know about where half of the people in the village are related to him.
The boys are on a DNA journey to discover their family history. Ant has just received a DNA alert.
You have a DNA cousin match in Drumkeyrin, not one, not two, but half the village. Oh, God. It's quite done, isn't it? Yeah. Oh, they might all be really fun people like me. Really good sense of humour.
Oh, God, can you imagine that village?
It's going to be great fun. I bet it's really good fun living there. I might move there. I'm not getting ahead of myself. I'm definitely going to buy a place in this village. I'm going to buy somewhere. I might be able to get there. I think I'm yeah. I think I'm running ahead of myself.
Just don't go on the estate agent's website. Just
I was.
We could not link Ant to any living McPartlands or McPartlands in Ireland. So we used the Irish phone book and we found a concentration of men with this surname in Drumkeyrin. So we went there and tested a number of these men, and it was amazing to me that all of them matched Ant on a marker that we had discovered uniquely in his own DNA. All these men were related to one another.
It turns out that Peter McPartlin, the war hero, well, his father was a Francis McPartlin, and his father was a Peter McPartlin, and they were both born in Drumkeyrin.
10 minutes away from Drumkeyrin. Oh, God. So when we get there, they know they've all taken a spit test as well.
Uh-huh.
They don't know I'm coming, so do I have to announce what the hell's going on?
Yeah.
So I've got to announce what's going on, OK?
So you've got to break the news.
I've got to break the news that we're all related, we're all cousins, because we've got an exact DNA match, right?
Amazing. I'm excited.
I'm excited now. A little nervous, I have to say. Because what do you say? Here we are. Drumkeyrin.
Wind. Down the end.
Who's that?
That's old. That's old Lizzie McPartlin.
2 pints in and she's off.
Yeah. 2 pints, Liz.
I wonder what they look like. I wonder how they're going to take to the news. It must be quite a shock.
They'll be devastated.
Shut up.
He's a grumpy looking guy with a big forehead. Definitely related, isn't he?
That's definitely a McPartlin.
All right.
Hello. All right. It's definitely one of your lot.
He looks a bit like my dad. So, I mean, is this Drumkeyrin? I mean, is that the end? Hold on. There seems to be a garage. Seems to be a garage outside the pub. This is not the smoking area as well, is it? Because there's something seriously wrong.
Oh, it's all getting a bit rowdy.
It sounds wrong, isn't it?
You better go meet the family.
Are we ready? Okay. See everybody. What am I having? So can you all hear us?
Yes. Yeah.
Now you're probably wondering why we're here. Yeah.
Yes.
Now you've all taken a DNA test, isn't that?
Yes.
I've also taken that test, and we have an identical DNA match, which means everybody in this pub and me, we're all related. We're all cousins.
Oh, yeah.
I suppose the first thing to say is, the drinks are on me!
I mean, there's definitely a lot of range in your work, Sanjay. Is that important to you? And what do you think the projects that you choose have in common?
You're right about the range. It sort of drives, I think, my team crazy, because just as we learn how to do one type of show, it's like we want to do something completely different. I don't know how sort of normal that is. I think there are companies who definitely just make documentaries or just make science programs or whatever else. And, you know, we like just sort of pretty agnostic about the form. We're interested in the idea and what's the best way of expressing that idea. I suppose what I have in common, I suppose, is two things. One is just instinctively drawn towards ideas that have that are difficult and have scale about them. You know, they're going to land and they're going to have an impact in some way. That's what I just love doing. But also, what's really important about that program, what I want to show about this, is that I'm obsessed with making programs that are popular, right? That are mainstream, that reach as many people as they can. I'm really not into sort of niche plays at all. And so it's one of the things I sort of find, actually, when you're talking to people who are kind of quite new into the industry. I mean, it happens at all levels, right? Because you would have had it when Fozzie was a Channel 4 commissioning editor. You'll still get the same thing at every level, but you get this sort of mindset sometimes, which is, there's nothing wrong with it, but it's a mindset which is, look, the film I want to make is a film about this, you know, Tibetan monk, or I want to make a film about the wrongdoing in Yemen, or whatever. And not even just that, but not just sort of current affairs films, but just sort of, you know, I think the subject is really interesting. I want to go and make a film about it. And I sort of think, well, that's great. But the question is, and by the way, I get it from my kids. My kids are like 23 and 21. They're forever giving me ideas about like what programs I should be making about climate change and all the rest of it, while they then go off and watch, you know, like Sex Education or play Fortnite, right? And I'm thinking, well, I said to them and I said to other people, are you going to sit at home on a Tuesday night and watch that program you just told me you want to make? And I think the answer is they won't. I think the answer is they won't sit down and watch that program on Tuesday night. Neither would my kids. And so my thing is, if you don't want to watch the programs that you're telling people like me that you want to make, then why should anyone else want to watch them? And so I guess my sort of challenge, I suppose, is always to think, I'm interested in audiences. I want to know how do I connect with as many people at a deeper level as I can, and how can we get them to see the world in a slightly different way than they did before? How can we emotionally reach out to them and engage with them? And I'm much less interested in sort of self-indulgent filmmaking, which is all about, this is for me. You know, I don't really care who watches it, right? And so I think, well, great, you know, there's got to be room for auteurs and passionate filmmakers who've got subject matter which is off, you know, off-piste, if you like. I guess it's just, the only thing I'd sort of think is that 95% of television isn't like that. 95% of television is like, it's First Dates or it's Gogglebox, so it's whatever. If you're going to end up with a career in television, the chances are you're going to end up with a career in television which is mainstream, which is trying to hit all the notes I'm talking about. And if your real thing is, I don't like all that stuff, I don't want to make all that stuff, I just want to make my Tibetan monastery film, good luck. Probably may not be the industry for you, right?
I mean, I think the important thing to add is that if you care about stuff and you're passionate about stuff, you can still bring that into these programs that, you know, you're hoping will be popular. It's not like you, I mean, I always say, you know, a trans woman winning Big Brother did probably more for trans rights than 5 documentaries about trans people. You know, I just think that there are ways to bring in what you care about into the films, which I'm sure you do.
I think that's completely right. I mean, I think the thing is, it's about, are you trying to make these films because you care deeply about issues? We all care deeply about issues. After Fozzie made The Family, I made the second series, or exec the second series, with a director called David Clues, and they basically cast an Asian family, a Sikh family, who were 8 weeks on Channel 4 at 9 o'clock, pulling in a big audience and a real insight and understanding into a sort of Asian family's life, which I thought, that's brilliant. At a time when this is pre everyone sort of saying we must have diversity on TV, and I sort of think that those values can come through. I sort of think Trojan horse telly is really good, right? Like, ultimately, you bring people in through for one concept, and actually through it you deliver, you know, values or content or journalism or whatever that maybe they wouldn't have come to if you hit them. So my main thing is, I love mainstream populist TV that can attract as many people as possible. That was watched by 6.5 million people, which is no mean feat nowadays.
Amazing. We can take a couple of questions at this point. Someone over there with their hand up.
Where do you find the money or like the sponsors for the projects?
Broadcasters. So it's always funded. All these programs are, well, for instance, that program is funded entirely by ITV. Right, so, and every one of my programs, Plane Crash was slightly different, but it was all funded. It was a coalition, and it was such an expensive program. It was funded by three broadcasters coming together. But generally, all of my programs, all of the programs we make, are all very simple. We come up with an idea, we go to a broadcaster, we say, do you like it? This is how much it will cost. And they'll say, okay, great. We'll either pay the money or we need to reduce it. But basically, the broadcaster pays.
Good afternoon. Earlier you said you go to broadcasters for your content ideas. So me and my brother, we make YouTube videos, edit them, shoot them on our phones. What sort of tips would you tell us if we're looking for content, like mainstream?
Do you mean in terms of how do you make that video into something that is more mainstream, or how do you come up with other ideas?
Yeah, how do you come up with the ideas and how do you make the video more mainstream or appealing to everyone?
It's really hard to answer the second bit of that, which is how do you make an idea more mainstream, because it might already be really mainstream without knowing the idea and seeing what you've done with it and seeing the execution. I suppose the essence of that would be, I don't know, like maybe show it to friends or something. Do you know what I mean? Do people like it? That's not a bad starting point. Do they watch it? Who would tell you the truth? You know, whatever. But I can't quite judge how niche or mainstream the idea is without seeing it. In terms of how to come up with ideas, that's a whole different session, right? That's like, you know, coming up with ideas and how you, the art of originating ideas and developing ideas and feeding in what broadcasters want and fine-tuning it. I think that probably would be quite a long thing to get into. It's a really good question, but I think you probably need another RTS session on development and origination of ideas.
Yeah, I mean, one thing I would say, I work at Amazon Studios, and we do a lot of research into what our customers want, and that's quite sort of detailed research that tells us who are the people they want to watch, what are the subjects people are interested in. So we use that, and I think all broadcasters use that, don't they? I mean, they have a sense of what their audiences want. I think also you can tell by viewing figures, right? So, you know, like if a programme does really well, you think, oh, well, that's obviously, you know, something people are interested in. What was it about that programme that people are interested in? How can we do more of that without being too derivative? So there are sort of different methods that we use.
Yeah.
That's a very sort of broad answer. okay, so we're going to move on to another clip.
I'm so sorry. I wanted to come back to the plane crash program because it's such a fascinating case. And after such a long and complicated pre-production process that you went through and almost losing everything on the moment there, were there any lessons that you learned from it or conclusions, such as flexibility, being open on the spot, or like trusting the people that are with you at that moment? Because that one camera captured the crash, so it's just, you know, sometimes we run into the same problem, just not on a plane crash scenario, but, you know, on the spot when filming a low-budget film.
Yeah, it's a really good question, actually. I suppose the, you know, you certainly learn that you can't expect... You can't predict everything that's going to happen. You can't control everything that's going to happen. All I think you can do, and I suppose the point of that plane crash thing was that's about as big a project as I think you can get in terms of factual. But nevertheless, the principles are still the same, which is put it up on a whiteboard, right? What's the goal? Goal is crash the plane, right? What are the obstacles on the way to that? What's the timeline? What are the different steps? You know, if you think about it, steps are going to be buy a plane, work out who, is it possible to actually crash a plane with no, because without pilots in it, because obviously you can't crash a plane with a pilot in it, they'll be dead. So how is the technology there and could it be built to get a pilot? Do you see what I mean? So what I'd be doing is saying, what are all the series of questions I need to answer to get to that end goal? And that's what I do with any of your things, which is I think anything can be project managed in that way. I think it's a big fan of deep analysis, right? Put it all out there, discuss it, and just plan it through very, very logically. It's one thing I actually was quite pleased with the law degree. It did teach me was like rigorous analysis. But I don't think you need the law degree. Any degree should be able to teach you that. And I think, or just, you know, any education system should be able to teach that. So I'd just say, plan it out and project manage it, right? And sort of think through as much as you can. You won't be able to answer everything in advance, but at least you've got a template then, and you can then work out, okay, what's the time scale that these things should take, and at what point do we need to worry, right? Because you can then sort of timeline each of these things. So if you haven't bought a plane by January of next year, we're in trouble, right? So then what do we do? And then contingency plan around that. I don't know if that makes any sense, but I'd say build a plan, build contingency plans, allocate time and money according to that, execute.
So we're going to have to move on. So I just realise we've got 10 minutes left and I really want to share this clip. So this next clip was called, it's from a series called The British Tribe Next Door. And it did attract a little bit of flack, which Sanjay will talk about in a bit. But basically, you sent Scarlett Moffat from Gogglebox and her family to live in a Namibian village in a replica of their British home. So we're just going to watch a clip from that now.
That's what you look like.
With the door finally open, more villagers are curious to see inside.
Come on.
It's you.
What?
Have you seen yourself before in a mirror?
Yeah.
You've never seen your face? It's called a mirror, and you see your reflection. Beautiful. That's you. See you tomorrow.
Yeah.
I'm nearly crying at the top of the stairs.
She's never seen herself.
Honestly, I can't believe it. I think it's just mad. Like, when I think of how many times we all check ourselves, and we're like, we wake up, we go and brush our teeth, look at ourselves, do our hair, wherever we go, even when we walk past a reflection, like, we
just
sort of look.
Instinct, yeah.
And then to never know what you look like.
So, Sanjay, this is a very original idea. Where did it come from, and what made it right to make at this point in time?
The idea came from a brainstorm like many years ago. In fact, it was one of the producers in the team who suggested the idea of going back to the idea of, like, where do ideas come from and how do you originate ideas? The idea was very simple, like, what happens if we put a house in the middle of the jungle? Like, build a British house, like, brick by brick, move it to the middle of the jungle. And so we got really excited and pitched it back then. This was like 12 years ago, I think, 10 years ago. And everyone said, well, why would you do that? Like, what's the point? And we didn't really have an answer to that. We kept thinking, oh, maybe it's an environmental thing. Maybe it's about, like, it's the dishwasher and the washing machine and, you know, a British family will move there and they're just in the middle of the jungle. And then it just didn't really go anywhere. The spectacle was there. It just didn't have anything more to it than that. And then all that happened was a few years ago, I read this book, some of you may have read it, it's a book called Sapiens, which is about the sort of story of mankind, effectively. And I was watching that, reading that, and sort of thinking about big questions there about, what have we lost and what have we gained as we've become these sort of advanced, you know, kind of metropolitan and civilizations and stuff. And at that point, I thought, well, hang on, is there something interesting here? Like, can we do effectively what's an anthropological experiment? Can we take, we've got two very distinctive ways of living in the 21st century, both completely viable and both with total legitimacy. And what can we learn from each other by putting those two ways of living side by side? So a British family in their house living side by side with a Namibian indigenous family living in their houses. And sort of what can we learn from that process? So I think it was a culmination of, I suppose it's like a big idea that had probably not enough purpose, that years later felt that by reading a book gave it the purpose that we needed. And when we sort of suggest that to Channel 4, they immediately didn't even have to write anything. They were just like, hey, we get it, we love it.
And why did you decide to cast Scarlett and her family?
I think it's about trying to connect in some way. So the reality of making television is that you, in order to make television that can become appealing and reach audiences that you want to reach with sometimes quite difficult and sensitive subject matter, because that programme also touches upon many different things like water shortage and ways of living that are being eroded, disappearing, and materialism and all the rest of it, about the way we live and the sustainability of the way the Himba tribe live. And so, you know, I sort of felt if you cast what would be an ordinary family, if you like, the chances of that being something that would appeal to an audience were less than if you cast a family that everyone knows. And therefore, rather than casting a celebrity family, it felt that Scarlett Moffat and her family had reached fame through being on Gogglebox, where they read as an ordinary family. But they had a warmth to them and a curiosity about the world and a kind of... but very little knowledge or understanding of the world we're going to send them into. So we sort of thought, actually, they were very likeable and very heartwarming and sort of characters I thought would be good to want to take part and want to be interested.
So this got a bit of criticism in the press. Can you tell us a bit about that and how you handled that?
I think it was very little criticism in the press, actually. I think it was criticism a bit on social media and stuff, very little, but it was noisy. And so I think from the first instance, before the programme came out, it was like, what are Channel 4 doing, right? I get it, you know, it was like, why are you taking this house? Why are you ruining this village? How, you know, preposterous, colonialist, how insulting that, you know, we're going to take all of our stuff and put it in front of these people, and what we're going to do is sort of change their lives and impact them, whatever. Obviously, it paid no regard whatsoever to the year of kind of really strict, diligent work the team had put in, a multicultural team, by the way, that put in into the prep, working with anthropologists, both locally and in Britain, to make sure everything we did and the way we did it would be done as sensitively and as without damage as possible. But the criticism, I suppose, was there was a criticism at the time that came about before the programme went on, which is what's going on. And then what I noticed was on social media as it was going out, I was a bit worried. I thought it was unfair, but I thought we were going to get a kicking. And what happened was, as the programme started, it was like, what is this programme? And then literally as it went on, it was like, I'm very surprised. I really like this programme. Too very quickly, we love this programme. And it did incredibly well for Channel 4. The responses were very, very positive. But there were people definitely then and now who feel that it was ill-judged, who felt that it was, in worst case, some people felt it was racist. In some cases, people felt it was offensive. And I mean, one of the reasons I want to show it was I'm really proud of it. I think it was an amazing thing we did. That clip is a very small clip. I want to show that clip because that's one of the clips that gets criticised, right? So, could have shown something, you know, whatever, but... and I sort of thought, I'm not sure why that clip gets criticised, because at the time it felt to me like a really emotional moment. This woman, for the first time, was seeing a reflection of herself, had never seen it before, was quite moved by and didn't, you know, I was trying to understand how to process that, and it's something we take for granted in our everyday life, so it felt to me like a really interesting kind of act to observe. So, those were the criticisms. But as I say, I take these things quite personally. I mean, I didn't really respond at the time, because the forum was there. But I thought, someone grew up in 1970s, 1980s in London. I didn't really feel like I was going to take lectures from people about what racism is. I know what racism is. That wasn't racism. Mm. That's, I think, what the debate was around.
I think we've run out of time, haven't we? But can I take a couple of quick questions? Is that okay? someone putting up their hand there very quickly.
Hi, this has been a brilliant talk, thank you. I was just wondering if you've had sort of a dream project that you've never really had the chance to work on, and if you'd ever like to see that in fruition.
I'm probably talking to the right person here because Amazon got tons of money. Look, do you know what? There have been a couple, actually. It's a good question. Please don't go and steal the idea, but if you do, good luck. Look, in truth, the one thing that I always feel was the one that got away from me was there was a film called Boyhood, in which they... I don't know if you've seen the movie Boyhood. It's an amazing film, right, where they track real... They film a child actor right through to 18. And I really wanted to make a film which would be about tracking somebody from the age of 13 to 18, so those kind of like the moment they turn 13 to the moment they turn 18, because I'd seen for my own kids what a kind of extraordinary brilliant period that is. And I thought, what if we just make one film in which that person completely grows up, like a sort of feature doc in which they change before our very eyes. We see this whole amazing transformation of the teenage years just go past in one film. And we came very close with it. We came very close. But in the end, the channels wanted to do something which is, how can we get a series out of this every year? I said, no, I don't want to make a series every year. I just want one film. I know it's less money for us, but I just want one film. In 5 years' time, it'll come out. And instead, they commissioned a series called Gifted, which is about gifted children, and it was a series every year, and then it sort of stopped happening. So that was, I suppose, the one I felt. I thought that could have been like amazing, and I thought, you know, you always want to do something in your life that you feel, when you look back, maybe I would have been wrong, but I feel, in my heart, I feel that would have been a really amazing film to make.
I think we've got time for one more question.
Hi, thanks for the talk. I just wanted to ask, what advice would you give to like a young filmmaker in the pitching process, since you both work in prestigious positions?
Pitching to who?
Like to broadcasters, like to get your film produced, yeah.
What I would say is, unfortunately, we don't take pitches from individuals. We only take pitches from production companies. So if you've got an idea that you really want to make, I think getting in with a production company, and you know, having somewhere that you trust and people around you that you trust, and then pitching it through their development team is the best way to get it in front of a broadcaster.
I'd also say, look, but even when you pitch to a development team or whatever, how you pitch is really important. It's actually a really, really good question, and I probably can't do it justice in the time available. All I'd say is, I think the worst thing people can do is be boring, right? And don't, it's not really that interesting about. Sometimes what you do with the pitch is you go through every single step of what led, a bit like I just did with the Vows Next Door, to be honest, but it's like you go through every single step of what led to that moment where you had the idea. I think you should just think, okay, what is the single most eye-catching and interesting thing about this idea, and then take it from there, right? What is the sell, and what's the treatment? If there isn't there, what's brand new, what's like not been done before, not been said before, and what's your take? Like, what are you interested in personally that makes me interested in your subject matter? So I think it's like framing the pitch a bit more and sort of thinking it through, like what's the top line and then expand out. So I think people don't rehearse enough. I think understanding how to pitch is really important, not just to broadcast, but even when you're in a team, you'll find your ideas won't get pitched to the broadcaster if you can't convince the head of development or, you know, the exec producer, because they'll be like, I don't get it. And they're short of time, they've heard everything. So how can you make them think? And I have it all day long. I've got my development team pitching ideas all the time. And I'm often like, it's so hard to get me interested, right? But sometimes somebody will just say something, I'll say, hang on, what, say that again? That's really interesting what you just told me. So I don't know what the magic is there, but you've got to think in that first minute, how are you going to grab the attention of someone who's busy and think, tell me more, I want to know more. I don't know if that answers your question, but and I'd keep it short.
I think that's all we've got time for, and thank you very much.